When you're talking short course off-road racing, you're talking TORC, the off-road championship. And the green flag drops on the season at the Red Bud Track in Buchanan, Michigan.
You know, the step up is so sick. The whoops are insane. Step down is like really bitching. The whole track has got unique features. I love it. I mean, the big rocks, super tight berms, huge ruts. It's like motocross big time.
Here you just go all out. It's do or die. You take every chance you can get.
It's a tough track. Yeah. I mean, you're constantly turning. You're always working.
The muddy track is what kind of concerns me more than anything. I've never really had to race on a muddy track that much, and this one's pretty muddy. Just the drivers got to go out there and just got to drive the trucks now, and it's all up to us to see what we can do this year.
The Pro Light Field returns with defending champion Casey Curry.
We're running the number one plate this year, so whatever it takes to be up front, hey, I'm not here to make friends. I'm here to win races.
Right on.
But repeating in 2011 won't be easy, with returning drivers like Andrew Cadell, Luke, son of Ricky Johnson, Ross Hook, and Brad Lovell. And with an exciting rookie class, including CJ, son of Johnny Greaves, RJ Anderson, and a former drift racer out of Sweden named Samuel Hubinette.
Not one bit concerned about Samuel Hubinette. He's awesome. And these guys that don't know him will respect him quickly.
The idea of one day competing as a professional racer is part of the American dream, even for those outside this country's borders.
I grew up in northern Sweden, above the Arctic Circle, a small town called Jokkmokk, only 4,000 people. Quite cold there, it was snow and ice 7 months per year. Driving a lot on slippery surfaces like ice and snow, you get used to being out of control and still being controlled. So basically you are going sideways and it's nothing weird about it. You just know how to do it because you do it so much. You just collect a lot of seat time. It was just consistently low traction. Even my mom going to the grocery store sliding around her car.
Sweden provided Sam the perfect environment to hone the skills he would one day need for off-road racing.
My dad was really into driving cars and motorcycles, snowmobiles. He wanted to push hard, so he got me behind steering wheel really quick in young age. Car control came really natural. Growing up there, it really benefited me throughout my whole career as a professional driver.
Sam turned his love of driving into a job with Volvo, and eventually a place on their racing team.
I was working for Volvo Car Corporation for many years as a test driver and did stunts for their car commercials, and I was in a touring car racing team with the Volvo team and did all kinds of cool stuff. But I did that for so many years, and then I felt I wanted to do something more now. I wanted to try something new. Life is too short to just stay with this. So I quit my whole job over there in Sweden and I took my big step and sold off everything, moved over to the States 2001.
Sam knew he was taking a huge gamble. But he also knew the only way to prove himself against the best competition in the world was to make the trip across the Atlantic.
It was a huge dream for me to finally make it over and get to see the country and all these big cars with big V8s and huge buildings, and it was spectacular. And then I heard about a group of Japanese guys from Japan came out to introduce a sport called drifting, sliding cars. I'm like, okay, that sounds familiar. I've done it my whole life. So me and two friends, we rented a couple of cars, went to the driver's search 2003 at Irwindale Speedway in LA. And there was 52 teams gathered there to try to grab these spots to go up against the top Japanese guys in D1. When I showed up there for the driver's search, I hadn't done drifting as a sport ever. I've been sliding cars and pushing over its limit, but I wasn't super familiar what they were looking for. So I looked at some online videos before we got there, and they listened to the driver's meeting, and they told what they were asking for was a big angle and hug the walls and push it hard, and unplug the traction control on our rental car there, and took a big risk. If I would have crashed the car, I would have been done. I would have had to call it a day and go back to Sweden because I didn't have the money to repair because no insurance would have covered. So it was like a big chance for me. I'm like, I'm going to go for it. This could be a career change. And it was.
I give drifting a lot of credit. It's a lot of car control, more like dirt, ice kind of racing. The car slid out. You got to use the throttle to get around the corner. You got to counter steer. I give drifting a huge credit.
Fortunate enough, I made it to actually top position. I qualified number one. The drift king from Japan told me I had the best score. So it was a huge turnaround for me. I saw, wow, this is going to be cool, and this is going to maybe get my reputation up in this country. Then 2004, February, a big event came up again, D1. And it was their first point event in the States. So it was a big, real deal event. And I was fortunate enough to get into a car with the Jasper Performance, the Toyota Supra, which was a great car for at that time. And I managed to battle myself up to top 10 position that day. And lucky enough, Mopar had a representative out there from Chrysler Corporation, BJ Birdwell. He saw me there, saw the event, he saw the excitement, how much energy was around there. And he called Detroit, and next day I had a phone call and they hired me. Since then, I've been a professional drifter also in my career, and that really changed my career in the States. So far I'm most first places in Formula Drift, and then here I am today going into a whole new venue now, off-roading.
As the newest member of the Mopar Ram Traxxas team, Sam couldn't ask for a better teammate than the legendary Rob McCachran. But as big a fan as Sam is of Rob, turns out, Rob is just as big a fan of Sam.
When I first found out that Samuel was going to be my teammate here with the Mopar trucks, super excited, you know, about it. I've been watching him on television doing his drifting.
Drifting is crazy. I actually got to go to an event a couple years ago, and just seeing how many fans they got there, I mean, they're doing something right there.
When you have a guy that comes out of drifting, he'll bring something to off-road racing that we hadn't been able to reach out to.
We're seeing these guys take interest in our sport, seeing how loose the cars are being driven around an off-road track.
And if we can pick up a couple of fans and he can show what off-road racing is about to them, and then, you know, draw a few of those, we'd sure welcome.
I've known Sam through BFG for a few years and know that he's a real good driver. I think everybody's kind of waiting to see how he handles some of this stuff. I think with his drifting experience, it sets him up perfect for the turning and style of driving.
Car control skills are kind of your fundamental. That's your foundation. There's a traction circle that exists out there, and you learn in racing. It holds. At some point, it stops holding. And being able to kind of walk that line in the circle is car control.
With his Mopar Ram Traxxas team behind him, Sam looks forward to the challenges and the differences he will face in off-road racing.
It's extremely hard to slide around cars and drifting and not hit each other when you're just inches apart from each other. Here, it's going to be some contact, and I love that stuff. I missed it from drifting.
A lot of people compare what we do to drifting because we're always sliding, but I don't think it compares at all. I really don't. He's out there doing a dance for his fans, and when you're out there fender to fender, I don't expect that to be a huge asset.
I just heard that Ross has a lot to say on the side of the track, and it's okay. Let's talk on the track. I'll see you out there.
If it sounds like Sam is using his doubters as motivation, it's because he knows he will have to prove to others and himself that he can handle the fierce competition of TORC. Sam realizes that despite his reputation, success on the track is the only thing that will gain the respect of the other drivers and the sponsors.
Like, I'm not listening to you. There's of course a lot of pressure when you have a big corporation behind you spending a lot of money here. They want to see results. They want to see results very quick. Of course, I want to be on the podium as fast as I can. And I have a lot to learn here in a very short period of time. So I'm going to have to really quickly figure this out. And there's only so many events too. And you've got to grab as many points as you can to bring home a championship.
He has what it takes to drive race cars. So I mean, it's going to be good. I think he'll be a great contender all year.
Casey and him had raced the Baja 1000 together. I've seen him drive. I know a little bit about his background, and I knew that he would be a force to be reckoned with out here. I mean, to me, it's a honor and privilege to race against somebody of that caliber, really.
And Hubinette's got this, he's got the turns down because he's a drifter.
But not everyone in the paddock is so sure that Sam will find instant success.
I think maybe some of our teammates might have questioned, hey, how's a drifter going to work in this racing environment?
This track might be a little difficult for him. Here, you got to pitch the thing sideways quick. Less about angle here than, driver control, all stuff. I mean, he's got driver control. I mean, that's what, you know, he's shown that in drifting, but these tighter tracks are going to be what's going to be tough for him at the beginning of the year.
He's a rookie. He doesn't know what you can and can't do yet, and he'll learn soon enough.
There are a lot of skepticism around, is he really going to be able to pull it off?
You know, he's obviously got a well-funded team. He's working for one of the best teams in the business. They spend so much money to bring new guys into the sport that don't have a clue how to drive. It makes you want to vomit. Hubinette, you know what? The beauty of Pro Light is they can't just outspend me. They can take their data acquisition, they can take their expensive crew chiefs, and they've got an advantage, but they got to outdrive me.
I'm going to go suit up too and then get back down here.
I'm going to go get suit up.
While the off-road community does not know Sam Hubinette, I know Sam Hubinette. Sam Hubinette is probably one of the most talented drivers in any form of motorsport that's out there today. And the car control that he has shown in his success at drifting and his previous background in rally and as a stunt driver, like it or not, it plays out on the track.
I got to perform. I'm an athlete here. If I don't, sponsors are going to start to walk away and I'll be standing there with no income. I have a newborn baby now, my little baby Stella, I have a wife.
What's at stake for him? I know that if, you know, he's not running well, they might find somebody different that can maybe run up front more. It's a lot of pressure. I mean, you got a big company there.
With big sponsors like Mopar, Ram, and Traxxas, Sam has the funding and the equipment needed to win. But a higher budget also means higher expectations and no excuses. Early failure could mean an early exit from the TORC series, and his very survival depends on finding early success. That's why Sam is taking advantage of his greatest resource, teammate Rob McCachran, and his many championships and years of experience in off-road racing.
All right, no big deal. He's definitely showed me that he's eager to learn and he wants to win. There'll be a little bit of learning curve to realize, you know, how rough needs to stick his nose in there and be door to door and rub a little fiberglass with some of his other competitors. But once he gets a taste of that, and you know, I imagine that somebody else will rub him first, and then he'll go, "Oh, I see how this goes," in his Swedish accent, and he'll get right after it, and he'll pick it up really quick.
So, did you make any big changes from last night?
I was at the hotel, but I hear the changes were phenomenal, and today will be very fast. But tell me about yourself, living in California.
I can't do it. Oh man.
Despite that Swedish accent, Sam's promise to do his talking on the track is a language every other driver can understand.
It's going to be a great time here. See some fenders flying off and stuff. I'm all game. I'm ready. Let's battle.
I think it's going to be an interesting year with 17 trucks, I think, out here for the first race. It's going to be interesting. Sam's going to fight for podiums at Crandon. He'll be fighting for podiums by the end of the year. He'll struggle, I think, here, but I think he'll be a lot better. I mean, I could be completely wrong, and he might come out there and win today. So it's I know he'll do good this year. It just depends on how he gets off in his first couple races.
TORC's a real, it's like supercross in a truck. Sam's gonna get used to it fast, but he's got a good truck going into it. It's gonna be more Sam getting used to in the air, setting the truck sideways, clearing the dirt out of his face, try to get into the front and see how good it goes. Sam says he's not nervous, but I think he's nervous. I think he's nervous with the mud. I don't think the car and the racing has the nervous part. I think it's the new experience that has him guessing what's gonna happen. Until he actually gets in the truck, sees how it's gonna be, I think he'll be good after that.
I had jitters last night, and this morning when I was driving out here, I got all excited and pumped up.
Sam said he would do his talking on the track, and the time to make his statement to the rest of the ProLite field has arrived.
All right, Luke, don't blow the tires off this thing. You're the one that said this thing's got a ton of power. So just, like I said, if you got a short shift it, just keep the wheels under you, okay, buddy?
Welcome, everyone, to the 2011 Traxxas Off-Road Championship Series presented by AMSOIL. The ProLite field's at the line here at Red Bud, Michigan, the notoriously famous Motocross Outdoor Nationals track.
Green, go.
Green flag is out, and Brad Lovell will pull a hole shot, and here's what the story of the day is going to be. All about the mud and track conditions. We've got some brand new faces in the field, and a lot of young guns as well, with some old wily veterans trying to work their way through the pack also. You see Ross Hook already, that orange Ford, throwing up a lot of smoke, and there's one of the new faces to the sport. Right there, Samuel Hubinette, who's known for notoriously wild drifting pro action. Samuel Hubinette, in his off-road racing debut, would love to put out a good show here today at Red Bud, but it's going to be tough since he threw last and is starting all the way in the back. Brad Lovell still maintains the lead. There's one of the wily veterans, Randy Eller, running in second. That Max is forward. Ross Hook in third.
Good job. Clear by two. Cadell's behind you.
Samuel Hubinette right there. The track splits. You have an outside line, which is a further way around, smoother. And the inside line has got that huge jump, which right there, Luke Johnson had a major problem and stumped into the ground.
Yeah, that's the line. That's the line. Go, go, go. You got Cadell by a half a truck, going away, two.
You can see Ross Hook right there trying to block some of that mud, saving those tear-offs for this race. And Sam Hubinette, Mopar Ram, moves up another spot. Something brand new for Samuel Hubinette, who is an international drifting star.
Big puff of smoke, it's gotta be out of your oil tank. Went away.
Ross Hook still showing a lot of smoke as Brad Lovell still maintains the lead. Absolutely, without a doubt, the advantage. So you can see the big, huge gap he has going back to second. And the helmet is absolutely clean yet. With Randy Eller trying to chase him down, Ross Hook still running in third. Andrew Cadell running in fourth. Cadell, one of the drivers running a Mopar Ram for the first year here in ProLite.
One on the fast route on the inside.
And there's a very good shot. Oh! As soon as you mentioned Cadell, he goes up and over lawn darts on that uphill jump. It doesn't look like anything structurally may be wrong. If they can get it back on his wheels, he might be able to get back underway without any severe damage.
Answer me.
Okay, I'm okay.
That thing turned back over. Get it unhooked and stay on this lead lap if you can. Turn back over, try to stay on the lead lap.
It sounds like Andrew's okay. He just wants that thing back on full wheels and get back underway on the lead lap. As the rest of our field comes around, there's bound to be contact in this race, no doubt about it. Samuel Hubinette still battling the muddy conditions. You can see he's not even touching the shifter. Oh, and there's contact maybe between C.J. Greaves and Casey Curry. As Curry's off the track trying to get his way back on, and he'll come back on right in front of Samuel Hubinette. Casey, you can tell just by the way he's whipping off those tear-offs that he's a little upset. Randy Eller once again still maintaining second over Ross Hook. Brad Lovell well up front of the rest of the field. Cadell now back on all fours, to see if he can back underway as Todd Cunningham and CJ Green battle for position right in front of Casey Curry and Samuel Hubinette. This may be one of those afternoons where slower is faster with these track conditions. Cunningham getting a little contact with Ross Hook and collects the rest of the field right behind as they all tap bumpers.
You're clear. Get in, unhook it. The trap is still hooked up. Hold up. Okay, hold tight there. Let him get the trap off. Do not move. Here he comes. Go.
Now, if there's ever a need for a spotter right there, you can see how valuable having a spotter on the track is to a driver. If you go back to the racing action, CJ Greaves now has gotten around Ross Hook. The next generation of the Greaves clan, son of Johnny Greaves, doing very well in pro life so far in this race.
Currently running seventh position, good work.
Ross Hook, Casey Curry, Todd Cunningham, Samuel Hubinette still trying to work his way to the field. His first race ever in off-road. Again, you can see where the lanes split, the outside-inside options. Again, the outside option is smoother, but longer way around. Sam Hubinette, the rookie from Sweden, is showing everyone why Mopar Ram brought him into the Traxxas TORC Series to race pro life. Getting a contact made. Looks like CJ Greaves is leaning just a little bit on Randy Eller, trying to get around the corner. It almost looks like right now the track is pretty much a one lane all the way around as Ross Hook is either smoking, then stops and starts smoking again. You can count on the muddy conditions to start clogging up the radiators just about any time now, and we're gonna start to see, I'm quite sure, a lot of overheating race trucks. Casey Curry taking a peek on the inside of Ross Hook, the outside-inside move. And again, Samuel Hubinette just whipping off those tear-offs. And Casey Curry still has not gotten around Ross Hook.
You got the rookie on your butt, that new dude, the Dodge Ram.
Hubinette trying to work his way around. You can hear the spotters are talking about him. Casey Curry tries the outside look, but it looked like Samuel Hubinette got around Casey Curry. Hubinette moves up one spot. And again, CJ Greaves. Oh, and that was Randy Eller. Over rotates. Now he's got front end problems. CJ Greaves gets around. Ross Hook gets around. The tough break for Randy Eller as he over rotated. And there may be something wrong now with the front end of his truck as he pulled off the track and his front wheels weren't even turning. And it looks like Samuel Hubinette now is off the track and back on for a moment. And now CJ Greaves is showing a little bit of smoke. Casey Curry, Ross Hook, Samuel Hubinette back on the track. Look how close he has the steering wheel mounted to his racing seat. Meanwhile, Brad Lovell up front all by himself. If you take a look back at Casey Curry and CJ Greaves. Again, they split the lanes. Casey Curry, huge jump to the inside. Will slide wide, and CJ Greaves comes right back. Casey Curry may have found something for later on in the race to try to get around CJ Greaves. Meanwhile, guaranteed, Ross Hook is watching the battle going on in front of him and taking notes as well. Defending class champion, the red number one plate of Casey Curry. Trying to reel in our leader, Brad Lovell. And Hook is still showing smoke. As here comes Samuel Hubinette to the inside, and he gets around Ross. And as you can see right now, the track is just not getting any better at all. As the mud clods are literally rolling around inside the trucks on top of the drivers. CJ Greaves. has fallen back one spot as Casey Curry has gotten around. Curry moves up one more position. CJ Greaves falls back one spot. Big air on a Greaves at the top of the hill, but he'll slide wide. Casey Curry comes right back, and now Hubinette's right there as well. The battle rages on between all three of the drivers, between CJ Greaves, Casey Curry, and Samuel Hubinette. Now that long left-hand sweeper past the hot pits. Curry's got the inside line. Greaves is stuck to the outside. And now they're digging out of the turn for the long straightaway. Hubinette tries to come back to the inside on Curry. Not able to do so, at least at this moment. Greaves gets a little sideways, goes to the infield banking a little bit. High side just enough to break up the momentum. And Curry gets back around. Meanwhile, Samuel Hubinette still trying to work his way to the front. His first off-road race ever. As his learning curve has just hit a mountain, not even an uphill, but it's a mountain right now. Curry, Greaves, Hubinette trying to work their way up and catch our leader, Brad Lovell. And Greaves slows to the left front flat tire. Sean Morris goes around. Luke Johnson gets by as Greaves goes into the hot pits.
This lap here is going to call it the competition yellow.
Okay, so we're going to do one slow lap and then come back and start.
Exactly. They'll create you around one and then we'll come back and they'll do the start again. No pressure from behind. Just work on him.
Copy that. I like to pass him fairly quick so he doesn't make it dirty. I'm thinking of you guys. I don't want you guys to have too much work afterwards. No, all I'm thinking about now is you to not have too much work to do because I'm such a good friend of yours.
Hey buddy, I appreciate that.
Having problems getting that jack underneath the front of the truck.
When we get rolling here, we're going to go single file all the way around the track, and then at the finish line where you're sitting right now, we're going to throw the green flag.
Okay. I could use the cold sprite right now.
Okay, Sam, we got a situation with the weather coming in. Right below. So, as soon as we capitalize, around them. I mean, don't spin them out or anything, but work hard.
Absolutely.
Bob is still safe. Truck's gonna pull off, get right up on them, and we're gonna go green.
As you look closely, it looks like Samuel Hubinette may have a problem with no more tear-offs left as we get ready to go back to green flag racing, and that could be a huge issue for the second half. Brad Lovell, Casey Curry, both go to the inside lane. Curry looks like he took the lead, goes inside Lovell, and has. Hubinette's coming right alongside. He gets around Lovell. In one turn, Lovell goes from the lead to third as our new leader, Casey Curry, and that Monster Energy Nissan now finds himself up front. Now Casey Curry's going to work. Hubinette running in second. Definitely has a problem as he is out of tear-offs. So the pavement drift star, making his first ventures into off-road, finds himself at a big time disadvantage right now. Both trucks still battling for that lead. Defending class champion, and I guess you'd say the old man rookie. Going after their first win of 2011. Both trucks now getting ready for that left-hand turn, up that big jump. Casey Curry going to the inside lane. Big air, big time air, and he shoots Green, he overshoots the jump. And here comes Samuel Hubinette.
There you go. Keep driving, keep driving. He told you made a mistake. Stay inside.
That could be the mistake that Samuel Hubinette wanted or needed to get to the front. And Casey Curry's gotta be trying to correct himself right now. Major mistake from our defending class champion. Here comes Casey Curry back to the inside line, taking a peek. He definitely does not want to run directly behind our leader, trying to find the line to the either inside or the outside, not directly behind. Samuel Hubinette in that Mopar Ram, now running up front. Could this be his first win, the first time he's ever been in an off-road race?
Your race now.
Here comes Samuel Hubinette. Just a moment ago, you saw Ray Curry, Casey Curry's dad, the intensity in his eyes, trying to get Casey, defending class champion, back to the front. It appears to be five laps remaining as Samuel Hubinette and Casey Curry both take the same lane. Both get the big air. There's the intensity on Ray Curry, spotting for Casey right now. Casey appears to be losing a little bit of ground to our leader, and still the intensity is building. As you can see, Ray Curry spotting for Casey Curry, trying to help his son catch our leader. RJ Anderson goes by. Ross Hook. Here comes Todd Cunningham. Luke Johnson trying to work his way forward in that Red Bull Ram. Looking out of the back of Brad Lovell, you can see RJ Anderson trying to reel him in again. Tough break for Brad Lovell. It's a little bit of luck tap right there by RJ Anderson. Tough break for Brad Lovell, as I said earlier in the race. He led, I think, all up to the first half. RJ Anderson had a brief encounter with another vehicle earlier in the race. As you can see, he's showing a lot of body damage. And RJ Anderson over-rotates in the turn to the dogleg, and here comes Ross Hook. Hook now has a shot to move up one spot. They split the lanes. RJ Anderson goes the inside lane. Ross Hook the outside. And once again, it looks like it didn't work. RJ Anderson hangs out of the position. A great addition to the series is having the option lanes like that. This is the only track in the series that does that. Once again, Todd Cunningham, Luke Johnson coming by. Randy Yeller still out there in that Maxxis Ford. Andrew Cadell back on all four wheels, running in that Traxxas Ram. Mitch Gore right behind him, CJ Greaves, all coming by. It's just a few laps remaining. RJ Anderson back on the rear bumper of Brad Lovell, trying to work his way forward. You can see how rough the track is getting, rutted up, dug up. There's maybe even spots where there's standing water and then dust a little while later.
The gap behind you. Back on level again. On it, get on it, he's fighting hard.
It looks like a three-way battle right now for that last podium spot between Lovell, RJ Anderson, and Ross Hook.
Three to go this time, three laps to go.
USAC officialing all the spotters know there's three laps remaining, and again, RJ Anderson just ramming into the back bumper of Brad Lovell, trying to work his way around. Lovell has a problem. Lovell pulls off to the side, comes to a stop, and RJ Anderson, Ross Hook, it looks like Lovell gets back underway, but he'll lose two spots, possibly three. Meanwhile, up front, Samuel Hubinette has a considerable lead in this track conditions over Casey Curry, and he's still using his hand to scrape the mud away from his visor. This track is definitely one lane all the way around. You can get hung up to the outside. You are not in the marbles. You are on a huge berm that you're gonna sink in. Big air on both of our top two trucks. Still a few laps remaining. Time is running out for the rest of the field to catch what could be our first time winner. Ross Hook is on the track, still showing a little bit of smoke. Luke Johnson, that Red Bull Ram, still beating on that back bumper of Brad Lovell. Manufacturer wars going on right now between Nissan and Ram. Ford another Ram, and a couple of more Fords, as well as a Toyota. Casey Curry is car leader. He's literally riding the back bumper of Samuel Hubinette. Brad Lovell. Oh, here comes Luke Johnson on the inside. Lovell almost comes to a stop again as Randy Eller, Andrew Cadell go by. CJ Greaves, and there's the white flag. Brad Lovell's have a major problem, so we go back up front as it's all about Samuel Hubinette and Casey Curry. Two truck separation, which is nothing in a track like this. Casey Curry's right there, takes a peek to the inside, still nothing there. Hubinette making that ram as wide as possible. The mud is still being kicked up. Through the rhythm section, trying to dig, trying to find traction. Hubinette went to the outside line, just law darts it hard off the jump, still maintains the lead. Now lap traffic of Sean Morris. Casey Curry had nowhere to go, thought he could go to the outside. Hubinette, once again, making that truck as wide as possible. Curry trying to get around lap traffic. Now finally does. It looks like one turn remaining. Curry's right there. Here comes our first time winner and first time ever in an off-road race, Samuel Hubinette.
That's how you work.
Yeah!
Good work, good work. Trying to get straightened out, not in the muck. There you go, follow the fence line all the way around.
And here comes RJ Anderson battling with Ross Hook. It's RJ Anderson, another one of the young guns, a rookie in pro life. We'll finish in the third spot. Ross Hook will finish fourth.
Samuel's got it going on. I mean, I've raced 1,000 with him before and been around some of the other races that he's done, and the guy can drive anything. And he'll be a threat all year, you know, and I think we're going to have some great battles, and definitely don't want that to happen again, and we're going to give it all we got.
Samuel Hubinette did a heck of a job, you know, being my teammate with Mopar and Ram. Just did awesome out there. He drew last and 16th, and he came all the way through the whole pack and went to the front.
He came out. He ran a smart race, starting last. He was patient, worked his way through the field. When it became go time, he just got on the gas and took the thing to the front, said, hey, you guys give me a great piece. I'm gonna take this thing for the win, and he did it. And it was just, it was unbelievable.
Today's Sunday, and today is a mess. It rained all last night. The track is a disaster, but I guess they're gonna try to run. The weather report says it's gonna be hail, 70 mile an hour winds, and tornadoes. I don't know, I guess we could race in that, but I'm down to drive no matter what. If they wanna race, I'm down, but if not, then I wanna get loaded up so I don't have to be sitting in it.
Yesterday, you know, we started second to last row or something, 14th, and just tried to run our own race, and by the halfway, we worked our way up to second, and right before the halfway flag, the track was getting real brutal and we hit a hole and got a flat and someone got into the back of me and wrecked my radiator. And I mean, it was a tough break, but we're back, we're ready to go and ready to take a win today.
CJ Greaves showed he was ready to take home the win by taking an early lead. But one driver in the middle of the pack began closing in on the trucks in front of him and closing in on the lead. Sam Hubinette's Mopar Ram Traxxas truck passed Casey Curry, then battled with Ross Hook, the driver who had compared drift racing to dancing. Sam vowed to do his talking on the track, and Hook was left speechless as Sam found his groove and moved past Hook for good.
They make just enough contact. RJ goes around. And it was just ever so slight at that perfect moment.
RJ Anderson's truck wasn't the only thing on fire. Sam continued to turn up the heat by pushing past Todd Cunningham for third place. Next up, Randy Geller's Maxxis Amsoil truck, the the last obstacle standing between Sam and the current leader, CJ Greaves.
Again, Eller pushes wide, cannot get his truck to rotate to the turn. Hubinette now running in second.
Meanwhile, out front, Greaves still smoking, but still pulling away from Eller and the rest of the guys.
But still, wow, 25 car length lead over Sam Hubinette.
I don't have a whole lot of experience, so I'm taking every little corner as serious as I can and just taking every information in.
By the time the drivers were given the mandatory caution, signaling the halfway point of the race, Sam had made his way up to second. And when the green flag dropped to start the second half, Sam set his sights on the one opponent left in front of him, CJ Greaves and his Traxxas Monster Energy truck.
Samuel, I saw it won the first day, and he was all over me the second day, and he was pushing me. I mean, we were slamming into each other and dooring each other. And I mean, he's an aggressive driver.
CJ, what a guy. I mean, he's just like a kid. He's so talented. What a guy. And I tried to get him, but he was going really hard and took chances, and I was like, I'm not going to risk spinning out. So I stayed solid. I had many car lengths to the car behind me, and I was hoping for a mistake, and he did. He came out too wide there, and I was there to grab it, and it helped me. So, you know, you just have to be patient sometimes and pace off, and yeah, here I am again, first place.
He's a great driver. I really have nothing against him, but really like to beat him.
CJ was leading. He should have won that race by a mile, but he made a mistake and lost the race.
Today was a big battle, man. We had many laps, me and CJ here. He was holding off very good. I was like, maybe I should settle for a second place. I was trying to stay solid, not making mistakes, and hoping he would do it. And he got a little big drift over here, and I got to tag around him, and it was fun. It was a lot of battle. And of course, the Mopar Power helped me a lot, and I'm just stoked to be part of this Mopar Ram team. Of course, with sticky BFGs, how can you go wrong? Hey, good job, great there, job, man. Dude. I didn't think I was going to catch. I was like, I'm just going to stick with second place. And then I was like, oh, maybe he makes some mistakes. And
yeah, he spun out there.
Yeah, I was waiting for that because I was like, you're fast. And yeah, I was just happy with the second place, too. But I'm like, if you make a mistake, I'll take it.
Hey, we got a fire.
Fire!
Fire!
Hey, guys, can you jump on?
I'll go to the podium.
What a weekend for this JBR Mopar Ram Traxxas team. Unbelievable to win our first Pro 2 race, to win twice on the podium on Pro Light. Sam Hubinette, unbelievable. And oh man, Andrew Cadell coming from dead last on a muddy track to get third. Unbelievable.
Wow, what a weekend. Two victories in a row. I mean, I'm thanking the team. It's no I in the team. It's all the guys here put a big effort in. I'm so stoked to have all these guys on board. It's fantastic partners. So stoked.
All right, well, good job once again.
Thank you.
You look good out there. You really did.
Thank you very much.
Looked like you're having fun.
It was awesome.
Yep. I'll get your phone number from you before you leave, too.
Absolutely.
And give me your wife's, too. I'd like hers.
No, I'm not doing that.
With two victories in his first two races, Sam Hubinette is living out his American dream while becoming a nightmare to the rest of the competition in the Traxxas TORC Pro Light Series.
I kind of thought he was going to struggle a little bit here with the tight track, but I was surprised he got up there that fast. I mean, he was up to second, I think, by the competition yellow from what I saw, and that's from starting to see dead last 16th.
Despite proving himself to the Pro Light field by winning the first two races of the 2011 Traxxas TORC Series, Sam still hasn't made a believer out of Ross Hook.
Obviously, Sam can drive, but that thing drove past me like I was on blocks, and that takes raw power. But until we have the documented proof that the engines are equal, we don't know. It's speculation.
I don't know if I buy that all the way, Ross, because I look at your Facebook page and it says that, you know, we're way behind again. We just washed the truck 2 days before the event and we're going to be late, and just like always. So that shows me that you're not doing the prep and the homework to get to where we're at. You're not doing the preparation right. We're not doing that. We are in the shop 70 and 80 hours a week to get the preparation to get to where we are. We're dedicated to it. That's why we're better than you.